بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to a new session from a film reading session. And as usual, we start with a neuro case. This is a 4 years old boy who came for doing MRI brain. This is the T2 weighted images, and this is the FLIR weighted images. Here we can see that there is a multiple subependymal nodular lesion along the ventricular outline of both lateral ventricle. We can see here these nodules along the lining of the ventricular system. These nodules are usually due to either tuberous sclerosis or gray matter heterotopia. Usually this is the differential diagnosis of such nodular lesion along the ventricular system. To differentiate between the nodules of the gray matter heterotopia and the tuberous sclerosis is to compare the signal of the nodules to the cortical gray matter. If in gray matter heterotopia, the nodules are similar to the signal of the gray matter. While in tuberous sclerosis, the nodules are different in signal. So in this case, we can see that the nodules are in T2 are darker or lower signal in corresponding to the gray matter. We can appreciate this more at the T1 weighted images. We can see that the nodules are higher signal in relation to the cortical gray matter. So this is not a nodule of gray matter heterotopia. The gray matter heterotopia, the nodules are similar to the signal of the gray matter, and this is not the case here. So these nodules are more likely to be nodules of tuberous sclerosis. The other way to differentiate between the nodules of gray matter heterotopia and the tuberous sclerosis is the orientation of the nodule in relation to the ventricular outline. If the nodule are perpendicular to the ventricular outline, as in this case, this is matching or goes with tuberous sclerosis. The nodules of the tuberous sclerosis are perpendicular to the ventricular outline. If the nodules are parallel to the ventricular outline, this is with the gray matter heterotopia. Here, the nodules are perpendicular to the ventricular outline. So this is, again, this is nodules of tuberous sclerosis. So these nodules are likely subependymal tumors of tubers of tuberous sclerosis. In the subependymal tubers of the tuberous sclerosis, we should measure the largest nodule, as if the nodules increase in size, this is may indicate the malignant, the potential neoblastic transformation to what called subependymal giant cell astrocytoma. If the nodule is increased, the size of the nodule is increased more than 1.3 centimeter, this is suspicious and may indicate a neoblastic transformation. This nodule is large, and its diameter is 1.4, so it is suspicious and may indicate this is a subependymal giant cell astrocytoma. As we know, the subependymal giant cell astrocytoma, the location is usually in the foramen of Monroe here. Although the nodule, this is show does not show the typical location of the subependymal giant cell astrocytoma, but the size of the nodule is large and is suspicious for the subependymal giant cell astrocytoma, although it show atypical site for the neoplasm. Okay. Also in this case, we can see another finding. This is the FLIR images. We can see that there is a multiple bilateral subcortical areas of abnormal signal, as here, multiple subcortical areas of abnormal signal exhibiting high FLIR and T2 weighted images. These lesions show a characteristic sign, which it stretch the overlying cortex. This sign is very characteristic and very pathognomonic for the subcortical tuber of tuberous sclerosis. The subcortical tubers, the tubers in the tuberous sclerosis, can occur at two sites, can occur most commonly along the ventricular outline, and these nodules or these tubers called subependymal tumors, and also can occur along the cerebral hemisphere subcortical in location, and usually show the characteristic stretching or expanding the overlying cortex, and this is a very characteristic and very unique for the subcortical tuber, that it's expanding or stretching the overlying cortex. So this case show tuberous sclerosis with subcortical tubers, subcortical tuber and subependymal tubers with the characteristic features of the subependymal nodule being different in signal in relation to the gray matter, and perpendicular orientation of the ventricular outline, and also subcortical tubers with characteristic stretching or expanding the overlying cortices. Okay, this is a 17 years old male who came for doing MRI brain. This is the MRI brain for this patient. This is the flare, and this is the T2 weighted images. Okay, we can see here different things. The first things or different abnormality. The first abnormality here is the presence of the cerebellopontine angle lesion, bilateral cerebellopontine angle lesion. These lesions are low in T2 and intermediate in flare images. We can see at better at post contrast, the patient injected contrast, and these lesions here, we can see that the lesions here is showing a rather homogeneous enhancement with intracanalicular extension along the internal auditory meatus, giving the characteristic ice cream cone appearance. These features are typical for bilateral cerebellopontine angle schwannoma or 7th 8th cranial nerve schwannomas. So this is bilateral schwannomas, especially if there is no dural tail. So this is not a meningioma. So this is a bilateral cerebellopontine angle schwannoma. And as the general rule, we know if you see bilateral cerebellopontine angle schwannoma, the patient is neurofibromatosis type 2. The neurofibromatosis type 2 is you should say the patient is neurofibromatosis type 2 if there is bilateral cerebellopontine angle schwannoma. So the patient is neurofibromatosis type 2, and in patient with neurofibromatosis type 2, you should look for another stigma of the neurofibromatosis type 2. What is the other stigma of the neurofibromatosis type 2? The neurofibromatosis type 2 is usually showing multiple schwannomas, especially the cerebellopontine angle. This is the first one. The second one is the multiple meningiomas, and the third one in the spinal cord is the ependymomas. The patient here didn't do MRI spine, so we should look for the meningiomas. We can see look for the dural surfaces to exclude meningioma. Here the patient does not have meningiomata. Actually, there is no meningiomas. Okay, but and we should look for another schwannomas. We should look properly for the site of the cranial nerve schwannoma. rather than the cerebellopontine angle. In this case, it is interesting that we can find another lesion here. You can see there is another lesion here. This lesion is below the left cerebellopontine angle lesion. This region is the cerebellomedullary angle lesions, and the lesion is similar to the four mentioned two lesions in the cerebellopontine angle, take homogeneous enhancement and show extension along this foramina. This is the left jugular fossa or left jugular foramen. This left jugular foramen is the actual path for the 9th, 8th, 9th, 10th, and 11th cranial nerves. 9, glossopharyngeal, 10th, vagus, and the accessory nerve is usually pass along the, arise from the medulla and pass along the jugular fossa. So these lesions, usually schwannoma, arising from the one of these cranial nerve, either the 9th, the 10th, or 11th cranial nerve, we can't differentiate between, or we can't say the origin of such lesion, but this is another schwannoma arising from the cranial nerve. Another site important to or search for the cranial nerve schwannoma is the hypoglossal canal. Here the hypoglossal canal, this is the hypoglossal canal on both sides. This is the site of exit, foraminal exit for the hypoglossal nerve. These lesions or these foramina can be appreciated at the coronal images. Actually, we can see here, this is the characteristic eagle head shape of the occipital condyle. The below the eagle's head, this is the hypoglossal canal. Above the eagle's head, this is the jugular fossa. So we can see that there is a lesion here in the jugular fossa, left jugular fossa, and the both cerebellopontine angle. But the right jugular fossa is clear, and the both hypoglossal canal are clear. Another side. So at this point, we can see that the lesion have, or the patient have, a bilateral cerebellopontine angle schwannoma and left jugular fossa schwannoma or left cerebellomedullary angle schwannoma. Another important site for searching for the schwannoma is the paracellular region, which is a site for the trigeminal ganglion. We can see here, this is another small enhancing region seen at the left paracellular region, at the region of the Meckel's cave, which is the site of the trigeminal ganglia and the branches of the trigeminal nerve. So this lesion, such a small lesion, is usually another cranial nerve schwannoma. You can see here the multiple schwannomas. This is the bilateral cerebellopontine angle schwannoma. This is left cerebellomedullary angle or jugular fossa schwannoma. This sequence is T2 drive or heavy T2 sequence done for the cerebellopontine angle lesions. And we can see here the Meckel's cave. You can see this is the Meckel's cave. This is the trigeminal nerve, and this is the Meckel's cave. And here the small lesions that is seen in along the Meckel's cave, enhancing Meckel's cave and representing small cranial, another small cranial nerve schwannoma. So the importance of this case is to remember to search for another schwannomas in patient with neurofibromatosis type 2. We can find, and in this case, we can find multiple schwannomas, and we should look for the expected sites of the cranial nerve: the Meckel's cave, paracellular region, the hypoglossal canal, the jugular fossa, and also the cerebellopontine angle or internal auditory meatus regions. These are the sites, usual sites for the cranial nerve, and by default the usual sites for cranial nerve schwannoma. And if you don't put in your mind this sight, you can easily miss such small lesions as here. This is a very small lesion, and if you don't look for it, you will miss it. Okay. In this patient also, there is another two things. There is another two abnormality or two findings. We can see that there is a hydrocephalic changes. There is a dilatation. You can see in T2. We can see this. There is a dilatation of the lateral ventricle. That dilatation is out of proportion to the extra excessive spaces. So this is the hydrocephalic changes. We go downward and see the third ventricle. The third ventricle is also dilated, and we can and go downward for the fourth ventricle, and we see that the fourth ventricle is also dilated. So this is type of hydrocephalus, is usually communicating type of hydrocephalus, not obstructive type of hydrocephalus with no size site of or no definite site of obstruction. So this patient have an also communicating hydrocephalus. The third point here is that the patient have absence of the septum pilosity. This is clear here. There is no septum pilostem in this patient. So this is a dysgenesis or absence of the septum pilostem. Absence of the septum pilostem could be isolated septum pilostem dysgenesis or absence or agenesis, or could be associated with schizencephaly. There is no schizencephaly here, or could be associated with septo-optic dysplasia. In the patient with septo-optic dysplasia, they have absence septum pilostem, and also they have a hypoplasia of the optic nerve. We can see here that this the intracranial portion of the optic nerve, and this is optic chiasm. It is optic chiasm. This is a relatively hypoplast. So this patient usually have a septo-optic dysplasia. They have an absence of septum pilostem, and there is a relative hypoplasia of the optic nerve. But we usually need some clinical information so that the patient have a visual deficiency, so to be sure that this patient have a septo-optic dysplasia, and by imaging to diagnose septo-optic dysplasia, you must find absence of the septum pilostem and relative hypoplasia of the optic nerve. And some say that in septo-optic dysplasia there is some pointing or inferior pointing of the inferior wall of the frontal horn of the lateral ventricle. This pointing is characteristic for septo-optic dysplasia, but it is not the rule for diagnosis of the septo-optic dysplasia. The septo-optic dysplasia is diagnosed by two things: is absence of septum pilostem and the hypoplasia or relative hypoplasia of the optic chiasm. Some cases of septo-optic dysplasia may be associated with pituitary abnormality, but in this patient the pituitary is fine, no abnormality seen in the pituitary gland. But as I said, the septo-optic dysplasia is two things: is abnormality in the septum pilostem and optic chiasm. We need in this patient just clinical information to confirm the diagnosis of the septo-optic dysplasia. So in this patient have a neurofibromatosis type 2 with multiple cranial nerve schwannomas. This patient have communicating hydrocephalus, and this patient have a septo-optic dysplasia. Okay, the third case is, this is an angio case, and this is one of the most important cases in angio and urgent cases in angio. This patient do a CT angiography of the aorta for severe chest pain. In the reconstructed images here, we can see the fusiform aneurysma dilatation of the ascending aorta. There is a fusiform aneurysma dilatation of the ascending aorta. The arch and the descending aorta show no definite abnormality. In the cross-sectional images here, we can see this is the dilatation of the ascending aorta. This is the post-contrast angiography axial studies of the aorta, we can see there is a dilatation of the ascending aorta. The diameter of the ascending aorta measure about 5.8 centimeters. So this is aneurysmal dilatation of the ascending aorta. We can see here an interesting finding and important finding actually. There is a concentric mural thickening. There is a concentric mural thickening in the ascending aorta. We can see this, the concentric mural thickening here. This concentric mural thickening here is important, is very important. The diagnostic possibility of the intramural hematoma should be considered. And this reveals the importance of the pre-contrast images before the doing the CT angiography. You should, in CT angiography of the aorta, you should do a pre-contrast, non-contrast CT study of the aorta to exclude the intramural hematoma. We can see this is the concentric mural thickening here. This concentric mural thickening here is hyperdense, relatively hyperdense at non-contrast study. This hyperdensity is diagnostic for the intramural hematoma. So this concentric mural thickening, hyperdense concentric mural thickening in the ascending aorta, this is an intramural hematoma. So this patient have an aneurysmal dilatation of the ascending aorta showing a hyperdense concentric mural thickening intramural hematoma. There are certain prognostic factors for the intramural hematoma. We should report them in our reports to say if the intramural hematoma have a good prognostic factor or have a bad prognostic factor, and usually differ in the surgical management. This certain prognostic factor is the first one is the site of the intramural hematoma. If the intramural hematoma involving the ascending aorta, this is have a bad prognosis rather than the intramural hematoma involving the arch or the descending aorta. And it has the same classification of the Stanford classification. So this is if the intramural hematoma present in the ascending aorta, this is Stanford type A intramural hematoma. If the intramural hematoma involving the arch or the descending aorta, this is Stanford type B. Okay, the thickness of the intramural hematoma. If the intramural hematoma have a larger thickness, this is have a bad prognosis than the just thin intramural hematoma. Okay, also the if there is associated aneurysmal dilatation of the intramural hematoma as in this case, and if there is an ulcer like projection or not. We can see here a very important sign and very important finding, this contrast filled outpouching. You can see there is a contrast filled outpouching extending beyond the wall. This is the wall here, and we can see this is the contrast filled outpouching here along the anterolateral wall of the ascending aorta. This is called ulcer-like projection. The ulcer-like projection, there is a contrast-filled projection that is widely communicating with the lumen and usually associated with the intramural hematoma. This ulcer-like projection carry a very bad prognosis if it is associated with the intramural hematoma. We can see the ulcer-like projection in the 3D images here. This is the outpouching here along the anterolateral wall of the ascending aorta. This is the characteristic of the ulcer-like projection. The last prognostic factor, if the intramural hematoma is associated with pericardial effusion, pleural effusion, and as we see here, there is a pericardial effusion, and this pericardial effusion is relatively hyperdense and indicate that is a hemorrhagic nature. So this is a hemorrhagic pericardial effusion, and in this patient, this intramural hematoma carry multiple bad prognostic factors and usually indicate urgent and rapid management, surgical management and intervention. Okay. This is a 53 years old male who came to do a CT abdomen and pelvis. We can see here at the right lumbar region, we can see a speculated mass lesion here. This is a speculated mass lesion seen in the mesenteric facial planes, associated with multiple smudging and stranding of the surrounding facial plane. This extensive smudging and radiation bands are typical for what called desmoplastic reaction. So we have a speculated mass lesion at the right lumbar region with a characteristic extensive desmoplastic reaction. Such lesions are usually typical for mesenteric carcinoid. We can see here that the lesion is seen at the right lumbar region, okay, with extensive desmoplastic reaction and radiating back band. This is an extensive desmoplastic reaction, okay, and cause adherent or tethering the surrounding ileal bowel loops with a small foci of calcification within the region. All these features are characteristic for mesenteric carcinoid. Actually, there is an important differential diagnosis for such lesion is the sclerosing paniculitis chronic stage. But the sclerosing paniculitis is usually involved with the left upper region, if left upper quadrant region, and involve the jejunal bowel loops, not the ileal bowel loops. So in this case, it is usually mesenteric carcinoid due to the typical locations. And there is another way to differentiate between both entities if there is an enhancing mural thickening. But in this case, the study was done in portal phase as routine, and in bowel lesion or mural lesion of the mesenteric carcinoid usually intensely enhancing and seen in the arterial phase. And usually we do an enterography to better visualization of such enhancement. In this case, the patient have an oral contrast, and this mural thickening, we can't say this is an enhancing mural thickening characteristic of the mesenteric carcinoid. But the characteristic location in the right lumbar region in relation to the ileal bowel loops can be confident to differentiate between the mesenteric carcinoid and the sclerosing paniculitis. The typical appearance of the mesenteric speculated lesion with extensive desmoplastic reaction and foci of calcification is very characteristic for mesenteric carcinoid. Okay, this is case is a little bit difficult one. This patient came with signs and symptoms of intestinal obstruction, and we can see here that there is marked bowel dilatation, multiple air fluid level here, multiple air fluid level here, and so the patient have a radiological signs of intestinal obstruction. And as the rule we said before, to search for or to localize the transitional zone or transitional point, you should start from the rectum and extend the proximal. This is much easier. Okay, this is the rectum. We can see here the rectum, and the rectum is extended proximally here. This is the rectum and sigmoid. Okay, this is the sigmoid here. This is the sigmoid, and here this is the start of the marked dilatation. So this is the transitional zone or the transitional point. The transitional point or the transitional zone here If you find the transitional zone, you should look for the cause of such obstruction, if there is a mass, if there is a mural thickening. But in this case, we can't find such a definite obstructing lesion. But we can see that there is a abrupt caliper change. This is the marked dilatation, and here immediately there is abrupt caliper change at the site of the obstruction. Such pattern of obstruction usually done by three causes. The first cause is the adhesion or adhesive band, but this usually needs a history of operation and the exclusion of the other causes. The second cause is the internal hernia, and this is not our topic. I will do a lecture for the internal hernia in details. And the third cause is the volvulus. And to diagnose volvulus, you should search or look at the mesenteric fat plane, searching for the characteristic whirlpool sign. The whirlpool sign, you should see it at the axial images and at the coronal images. You can see here at the coronal images, this is the site of the obstruction here, and this is the characteristic whirlpool appearance. You can see here, this is the whirlpool sign. This is the whirlpool sign. Yes, this is a characteristic for the characteristic volvulus. So this case of a sigmoid volvulus diagnosed when you see abrupt caliper changes, and you search for the whirlpool sign along the mesenteric facial plane. In cases of volvulus, you should look for two things. The first thing is, if the vessels distal to the site of the whirlpool is obstructed, searching for the intestinal ischemia, and the volvulus is a very common cause for intestinal ischemia, but there is no bowel wall thickening here, and the bowel distal to the site of the volvulus is normally opacified or normally enhancing. The second thing is to that the volvulus cause what's called a closed loop bowel obstruction. Again, the closed loop bowel obstruction, I will explain this in the lecture of the internal hernia later. It usually obstructs the bowel in two points, and in this case, this is the sigmoid colon. We can see this is the marked dilatation. This is the sigmoid colon, and the sigmoid colon is obstructed here at this point and obstructed here at this point. So this is the 2 point for obstruction. This is the first point, and this is the second point. So the bowel dilated here, the sigmoid colon, cause have the characteristic inverted U shape and extending into the left hypochondrial region. This is a very characteristic for the closed loop pattern of obstruction. This pattern of obstruction in the sigmoid volvulus, known in X-ray as the coffee bean appearance. We can see here in the scanogram the characteristic appearance of the sigmoid colon dilated, and the pattern of the coffee bean with internal lines here. This is representing the adjacent bowel wall. So this is a sign, or this is a case of a sigmoid volvulus with proximal large bowel obstruction. Okay, the last three cases are MSK cases, and they are much simpler than the previous cases. This is a typical or spotty case here. We can see here that there is acromial clavicular osteoarthritis, and we can see this is a supraspinatus tendinopathy, but we can see here there is a fossae or area of dark T2 and stair signal, persistent dark T2 and stair signal, And even in T1 weighted images, the lesion is, or the area is extensively dark, this usually representing calcification, and along the course of the supraspinatus, so this is characteristic for calcific supraspinatus tendinopathy. When you see such dark, persistent dark signal lesion in different pulse sequence, you should suspect of calcification along the supraspinatus tendon. This is usually calcific supraspinatus tendinitis. The calcific supraspinatus tendinitis is much easier to be appreciated in CT or X-ray. It's more difficult in MRI. Okay, this is another shoulder case. This is a patient who have a history of dislocation, and we can see here that there is a avulsion fracture of the anterior inferior glenoid labrum. This is not a glenoid, this is not just a labrum, this is the labrum and the underlying osseous glenoid, and the fragment is a large fragment. And if we measure the width of the fragment here, this is fragment is extend exceed 7 millimeter. So this is indicate there is a significant glenoid bone loss. So this is an osseous Bankert with a significant glenoid bone loss, large separated bone fragment causing significant glenoid bone loss. And we can see here there is a marrow contusion at the posterolateral aspect of the humeral head. This is an impaction injury or Hill sac injury. So the patient have an osseous Bankert with a significant glenoid bone loss and separated large bone fragment, and there is a posterolateral humeral head marrow contusion or marrow impaction or cause a Hill sac injury. In cases of the shoulder dislocation and Bankert lesion, you should look for the underlying osseous fracture and the posterolateral humeral head for the Hill sac. But also we must look for the inferior green humeral ligament. In this case, we can see there is a disruption of the inferior green humeral ligament from the humeral attachment, and the fluid here in the axillary recess is spilled out into the axillary region. This is the confirmed diagnosis that there is a humeral detachment of the inferior green humeral ligament, which is called Hagel or humeral avulsion of the inferior green humeral ligament, and it is common in a patient with a history of shoulder dislocation. The joint effusion here in T1 weighted images, we can see that relatively high attenuation in T1 weighted images, and this indicate that this joint effusion is usually hemorrhagic joint effusion. The last case, another case with a shoulder dislocation, we can see here in this patient also the characteristic posterolateral marrow contusion, Hill sac injury. And we can see there is a avulsion of the pony of the glenoid labrum without affection of the underlying bony ridge. The bony ridge is pointed and there is no definite osseous fracture, but we can see there is a definite avulsion or separation of the anterior inferior glenoid labrum. And the fluid signal here is disrupting the or separating the labrum and also the periosteal attachment. So this labrum is no longer attached to the glenoid either by direct or through the periosteum. So this is not not Perthes lesion. This is a Bankert lesion. So the patient have a Bankert lesion with avulsion of the anterior inferior labrum and Hill sac injury. The interesting thing in this case is the extension of such abnormal signal to the upper labrum. We can see this, the abnormal signal, and if we go up in the anterior superior labrum, we can see the extension of or the continuity of the abnormal signal along the anterior superior labrum, and we can see that the signal is extending to the superior labrum. This is can be appreciated at the coronal images here. we can see this is the superior labrum here, and this is the abnormal signal extending within the superior labrum. And this pattern of injury is called extended Bankert lesion. This is not a Bankert only. This is extended Bankert lesion to involve the superior labrum. It is not a usual scenario or usual case, but it can occur. The tear in the anterior inferior labrum extend to involve the superior labrum, and in certain cases even involve the posterior labrum or the whole labrum, but it is not that common. So this patient have an extended Bankert lesion, Hill sac injury, and also the effusion here is relatively high, attenuation at T1. This is a hemorrhagic joint effusion. Thank you very much. Hope we will meet soon, inshallah. Thank you.